What's going on, people? How you guys doing? Let's see what's going on here. Let's see. Just doing something different. Always doing something different. I do apologize for. Trying to figure out where the focus is at. There we go. Perfect. I know, right? Trying to do something different, Caesar. No need to watch the riots. You can talk dogs, you know what I'm saying? Who wants to watch a riot when you can talk about dogs? You guys can't hear me. Okay, hold on one second. Let me figure this out. Can anyone hear me? Check. Okay, perfect. All right, let me get to another screen real quick. How do you guys feel about the new setup? You got a background, you got lighting, you got audio. If I had my, let's see, I'm not able to play. Well, I don't want to play music from there. Honestly, I don't. Let's see, boom. Man, well, I'm trying to step it up. I'm actually going to be working on, okay, I keep losing focus. So I don't know what's going on with my camera. This right here, focus, let's get to focus, there we go, perfect, it'll be back in focus in a second, you know what, what's popping, man? I actually sent out a direct message to Chad Mayo last week, to see if he would want to come on and do a live stream with me. So I did reach out to him. You should, if you know him, you should reach out to him as well and see if he's up for it. I'm also reaching out to David Levitt and Alan Scott. See if I can get some interviews with those guys as well. Trying to figure out where my then there's a guy out there. His name is Saladin. I think that's how you pronounce his name. He's a brother from New York. He's done a lot of research and really goes deep into the whole Cane Corso history. A lot of the band dog type breeds. He's very big on the Corso, Rottweilers, Mastiffs. Oh man, that's going on with my focus. I'm going to. There we go. Let's leave it like that. I think I touched the keyboard. So, yeah. So, let's see. Any more questions coming up? Let's see. What's up, True Bulldogs? How's it going with you? Man, this thing is just really... Give me 1 second, guys. I'm going to do something. Hold on. We're going to leave that just like that. I don't know any good Corso breeders in the Midwest. I'm going to tell you guys, honestly, I don't recommend dog breeders. I just don't want to get involved in the business. I don't want to, there's no upside to recommending a dog breeder. I mean, there are a lot of great dog breeders out there. I mean, I think, you know, but dog breeders are like girlfriends, right? Like, you might like a girl for yourself or your friend, but that doesn't mean your friend's going to like them. So it's always best that the person who's looking to get the dog, does their research and figures out exactly what it is that they want, and then find a breeder for them. I just did a video a little while ago, though. I suggest that, you know, go get out to dog shows, go get out to clubs that that have, you know, that we're kind of course are participating in the events, and figure out if you can or try to meet somebody that can recommend a great breeder to you or has great dogs, and maybe you can get a dog from them. Now, buying a dog is a I think you have to be patient. You can't just, you know, get a dog next week and or want a dog this week and get it next week. I waited a good 2 years to get my dog. Rolling Bay, my favorite dog breed, I guess, technically is the Rottweiler. I just bought one and very happy with him. Gerardo, I think a Bull Mastiff is cool. I mean, have you, for a first-time owner, I mean, you know, if it is your first time, I would just say try to partner up, you know, get a breeder who can like be very lives close to you and help you with the dog. They are big dogs. They can be they're big, they're powerful. They can do a lot of damage if they set their mind to it. But they are kind of a low energy large dog, not a lot of aggression. Depending on the bloodline, so you want to find the right breeder. I would say, you know, Showline Bull Mastiff would probably be better, or would probably be the best place to start looking for a Bull Mastiff for a first-time owner. And then also make sure that you have someone that can mentor you and work with you when you get the dog. You should be fine. Do a lot of research, and make sure you're right for the dog as well. Make sure you're a good leader, because large dogs need good leadership. Yeah, big run. Yeah, I hope everybody's safe. These are like the craziest, like, sheesh. When this COVID thing hit back in March, I was like, yo, this is the craziest ever. Now, man, it's crazy to the fourth power right now. It's a little bit hard. I'll be honest with you. So much has been going on. With the news and all that stuff, I've been very distracted. That's why I didn't put up any videos this week. I've just been real distracted. Me and my wife have been having a lot of conversations, and I've been spending a lot of time with my kids. Okay. Who? YC Auto Detailing. So you're a Call of Duty fan. So if you play with me, I must have killed you about 3-4 times. Tell the truth. How many times did I kill you? Or were you on my, I guess you were on my team if you heard my voice then, huh? Yeah. Yeah. That's cool. That's what's up. What's your handle? Marius, if I had to choose between a pit bull and a Amstaff, for my life right now, I would probably choose an Amstaff. What's up, Big Red? Man, Rottweilers are the best. They're not the best. I mean, they're perfect for me. But there are a lot of great dogs out there, a lot of great dog breeds out there. The reason why I would take the Amstaff over the pit bull, because I don't need the dog aggression, and I definitely don't, you know, and I mean, Amstaffs are very athletic and energetic dog breed, but they're not necessarily, energetic and what do you call it and dog aggressive as the American Pit Bull Terrier. H. Lee Robinson, is that someone I should be interviewing, Steezley? Is that you're recommending that I reach out to that person? I'm not big on mixing dogs, true bulldogs. I mean, you know, like, what job are you doing with the French Mastiff and the oldest English Bulldog? Where are you getting your French Mastiff from? What's the purpose of the mix? Uh, Noob, the difference between a purebred and a crossbred is purebred dog is a breed that's established by a kennel club and has a breed standard. So, like, for example, a Rottweiler bred to another Rottweiler will produce a purebred litter. If you bred a purebred Rottweiler to a purebred Doberman Pinscher, that dog would be a crossbreed because there's two purebreds involved. If there's more than two purebreds, or if you don't know the origin of the parents, those will be mixed breeds. So hope that makes sense for you. Manu, good morning, my brother. You're living in the future, man. I'm in L.A., so, well, yeah, it's only 11 o'clock here. I'm sure it's probably tomorrow where you are. Are American bullies dog aggressive like the American pit bull terrier? Not at all. They shouldn't. There may be some dog aggression, but they're really not. They're not a very high-energy, high-drive dog, so it's not really an issue, I don't think. It shouldn't be an issue. Can you do another document on Spanish and Lionel? I would love to do another video with the Spanish and Lionel. I need to get a hold of some footage or something. I don't know. I need to get out of this quarantine. It's driving me batty, man. I need to get up out of the house, to be honest with you. Let's see what's going on. Stream key. Share this video. This is what I want. Copy. New. Paste. Boom. Let's see if that works. All right, there we go. Yeah, I've heard of Chad, man. I don't know if you just said, you just asked me this, what's popping. When I reached out to him like last week or maybe a week and a half ago, I sent him a DM on Instagram, hoping that he gets back in touch with me. I'm not sure if he checks his DM or not. I don't really know. I think I met him before. I think I actually had a conversation with him years ago before he got he still doesn't really have the precedent in my, I guess, fully realized yet, but I have talked to him before, I believe, and I did reach out to him. So we'll get him on and we can do an interview. True Bulldogs, you're saying that you were trying to breed a healthier bulldog. Is that what you said? I'm sorry. I'm reading everybody's comments. So I'm just tell me again. Why are you crossing the French Mastiff into the Old English Bulldog? Alan Joseph, Borbul or Connie Corso? You honestly, bro, you have split the litter. That's basically 50-50 for me. That's a toss up. I think right now I would take a Connie Corso, but tomorrow I probably would take a Borbul. It's a tough one. Has my top Mastiff list changed? Probably. I would have to go look at it. Like I said, like right now, I think the French Mastiff, I'm sure the Borbul was probably ahead of the Connie Corso. Right now, I think the Connie Corso is ahead for me. But, you know, I don't know. I have to look at my old list. I think I'm going to start doing a list every year. So my favorite dog breeds do change. All right, True Blood, True Bulldogs. I mean, listen, you know, you would honestly, I'm not into like just the mixing of dog breeds. I'm not into crossbred dogs. Unless they're being done by somebody who's like really has a like working purpose for them, like in someone that has a lot of experience. There's a guy out here named Callie Catchers. He does a lot of crossbreeding, and everything he does is very interesting to me. But I know that the work that he has his dogs doing is a very specific thing, and he's been dealing with dogs for a long time. I would say, I don't know how old he is exactly, but at least 25, 30 years. And, you know, he has a lot of experience doing that. So, I'm not into designer breeds. I mean, you know, if you have a purpose for the dog, like a working purpose, to me, that's the only reason to cross dogs. for a bigger bulldog. I mean, honestly, if you want a bigger bulldog than the old English bulldog, you can get an American bulldog. It's very simple. If you want a bigger, and then you probably would just have to figure out how to get some real working French Mastiffs. I don't know if there's anyone out there with, like, legitimate working French Mastiffs right now. But that very well may be the biggest bulldog you're going to get. I have heard of American Sentinel Canine. And actually, I should reach out to him. I talked to that guy last year. I was supposed to go to Mississippi and actually do an interview with him. But I forget what happened in my life where I wasn't able to travel. But you know, I'll reach out to him. Maybe I can get do a live show with him as well. Alan, which breed is more sociable, Corso, kind of Corso? I mean, off the top of my head, I would say probably the kind of Corso, but that's only because they're more kind of Corso that are being bred for the show ring. So there's not a lot of Borbles being bred for the AKC show ring right now. So you will probably have an easier time finding a very sociable kind of Corso than a Borble. But that doesn't necessarily mean that, you know, that every kind of Corso is going to be more sociable than every Borble. It just really depends on where the dogs come from and what they were bred for. Yeah, I mean, honestly, bro, if you're looking for a bigger, like, the French Mastiff is laid back, but, I mean, yeah, it's very laid back, but I don't know if, you know, you're going to get a balance between lazy or active. I don't know what that means exactly. I want the perfect balance with being lazy or active. I don't know if there's a such thing. I mean, there are a lot of dogs that are big that will work when it's time to work. Like a Rottweiler is a perfect example. Like if you don't have anything for your Rottweiler to do, he will chill. Great Danes are the same way. Most master breeds are like that. So I don't know that you need to. Honestly, I would be, and I hate to give this idea, but I would be more interested to see what would happen if you mixed a Bull Mastiff with an Old English Bulldog. I know some of the Levitt stuff has Bull Mastiff in it already. I'm not certain though. That's just what I think I remember. Eddie Betty, what up? Thanks for all the good work, homie. Keep up the good content. Thank you, brother. Appreciate you. Justice for George Floyd. Right now, I'm with that. Justice for everybody. Justice for the world. I mean, listen, George Floyd definitely didn't deserve what was given to him or how he was treated. I mean, I'm a bit older than probably most of you guys, so I've seen this a lot. So if I'm not, like, fired up about it or whatever, just understand I've lived a life and this ain't the, unfortunately, I've seen tragedies like this happen before there was social media, and it's never cool. But at this point, you know, I just pray for a better world. I definitely pray that we get this together because listen, the world has all this technology. We have all this money. We have all this innovation, all this stuff going on, man. We could really do a lot better for everybody. This world ain't got to stay fucked up. Excuse my language. This world ain't got to stay messed up like it is right now. Let me keep going. I do not, Alan, I don't breed dogs. Noob, I don't know if there's a way to identify your dog's bloodline. I mean, even if you got them tested, I don't know that the DNA databases keep records of bloodlines like that. Maybe. I don't know, though. I doubt it. Louis Santiago, I got a German Shorthair Pointer. Your video on the breed helped me a lot. Awesome. He's a handful. Congratulations. I like German Shorthair Pointers. If I was a hunter or someone that went out hunting, I would definitely consider getting one. I mean, it would be the German Shorthair Pointer or the Visa. And honestly, it would just be the German Shorthair Pointer. I like them a little bit bigger. They're a little bit bigger. They're a little bit sturdier looking. I like the German Shorthair. I actually would love to see what a Drathar looks like in person before I really pulled the trigger on that. If I was going to pull the trigger. Interview would be great. He's purpose breeding dogs for hog hunting and protection. Yeah, you must be talking about American Sentinel kennels. That breed is beautiful. Alan Joseph, I actually have a video with Roughhouse Kennels on my channel. It's called The Original Cane Corso. You should check that out. Malinois German Shepherd. Honestly, it's an easy call for me. If it's for me personally, German Shepherd, I can't deal with Malinois. They're like, man, they can be annoying, bro. They always want to do, so they're busybodies, you know what I'm saying? So my thoughts on weight pulling. I think weight pulling is cool. I mean, you know, you got to find a dog that loves it, though, or loves doing it, you know? I mean, I know a lot of people try it. I mean, just try it. If your dog loves it, then I say do it. I don't think there's really any cons to it. I mean, obviously, you could injure your dog, but that can happen with any physical activity. So the pros would be, you know, having your dog focus on something. Having an activity for your dog, having a thing that your dog enjoys doing is always a pro. I know some dogs, I've been to some weight pull events, and, you know, you see dogs, when they see the track or they see the little sled or whatever, they get excited. And to me, that's probably what you want to look for. And then figure out, if your dog loves it, then it's a no-brainer, just do it. Just make sure you're not pushing them too hard, because you can, dogs like anybody can catch an injury doing lifting weights or pulling weights. Alan Joseph, what's the best way to preserve your dog's hips and joints? I mean, obviously, you don't want a puppy. You don't want it. If you have a large breed dog, you don't want your puppy doing any running, jumping, anything excessive until he's like 2 years old. Dogs can have bad hips, but sometimes it can be like, this is like anything. If you are a football player in your high school years, you might have a hip injury, you might have a knee injury, and then you turn 21, you can't play college ball, or you can't go pro because you got bad knees. You weren't necessarily born with them, but you kind of damaged them going too hard at a young age when your body hadn't finished growing, when your joints hadn't settled. So the best way, I think, to preserve dog's hips and joints, proper diet. I forget what the two minerals or nutrients they are that you balance to make sure that the bones grow steadily. I forget what those are. You can check those out. You can just Google that. I'm sure that someone will tell you what to feed your dog to make sure that the bones grow at a steady pace. And then, you know, no heavy exercises, no jumping over fences, jumping off of beds even, because, you know, dogs can catch injuries or shift something while they're growing. Warble or Kangol? Aiden, Michael, and me. That's a great question, bro. I'm going to be honest with you. Damn. I like Kangols. I love Warbles, though, but I'm starting to like Kangols, honestly. But for me, I would never get a Kangol because of his long hair. You know, I got a Rottweiler now. I'm realizing that his hair is longer than I kind of really wanted to be. But, I mean, those are two great breeds, though. Right? I can't front on either one of those breeds. I like them both. But if I had to pick one for myself, I would say Warble. But if I had to pick a better dog, I might say Kangol. If that makes any sense. Like, for my life, I would probably want a Warble, but if I actually had to deal with a working purpose of the dogs, I would probably say Kangols are better. I don't know a whole lot of Troy. I don't know a whole lot about the Canis Panther. There's not a lot of them around, so it's kind of hard. It's kind of hard to speak on them. I mean, they're like a crossbreed for the most part. And there's not a lot of people with a lot of them. So I haven't seen a lot of great ones. I've seen some cool ones, some good ones. They're a cool dog. I don't know, bro. I don't know enough about them. How many years have you been studying dogs and their behavior? I like to think that I started studying dogs in probably all my life, to be honest. I've always been a dog lover, documentary watcher, dog book reader, but nothing too intense. Like it's just my thing. In 2004, though, I started focusing a little bit more on larger breeds because I was looking for a dog for myself. And then, like, around that time, you know, the internet, in terms of speed and everything, really got cracking. So, and then there was a lot of information on the internet. So, I would say around 2004, 2005 is when I was just kind of always reading stuff and trying to figure out which dog breed I wanted. Now, I was very casual back then because I lived in an apartment at the time. So, I wasn't really going to get a dog it wasn't like I was getting a dog the next day. But I still wanted to just kind of wanted to figure out what I want. And that's when I discovered dogs like the Boerboel, the Conic Corso. I had already known about Rottweilers, Dobermans, Pit Bulls when I was younger. You know, Pit Bulls were everywhere. So I had a lot of experience with them. And then I started a channel in 2009 doing American Bullies. And I started doing just more and more research. I mean, honestly, like I said, I'm not an expert. If I was an expert, I would just sit here and talk about it myself. I really try to go out and find experts and have conversations with people. That's how I learn a lot of what I learn, just actually firsthand conversations, you know, asking questions that I need answers to. Let's see. Cali saw nothing with the Renaissance. But right now, honestly speaking, bro, we're in the middle of a stay-at-home order. I'm not doing anything, unfortunately. So nothing is in the works, right? Like right now, the only thing in the works is for me to, I got my room set up. So now I'm going to figure out how to start doing some live interviews with folks. You know, honestly, bro, I ain't gonna lie, Leo or Lyle A, my plan was this winter was really my plan to get a lot of, winter is when I get, you know, get the gun dog footage, because from January through March and April is our hunting season, so that's when I go out. I should have started earlier, but we had a real funny winter in California. It rained a lot. If you know anything about electronics, they really don't do well in the rain. So, Winston Barker, how's the training going with the dog? Honestly, Roscoe hasn't been to training for 2 months now, ever since the lockdown order. I do train him around the house. I do what I do with him. But I don't really get... I don't get to take him out of the house too much, which is really kind of depressing because the whole plan was at this point in time, Roscoe turns one in about a week or so. It's like June 6th, I believe, is his birthday. So this time next week, he'll be one. And at this point, there were so many events that I wanted to do. I wanted to take him to dog shows. I wanted to kind of maybe get ready to start doing some obedience competitions with him. We're nowhere near ready for obedience, though, I'll be honest with you. Like, he's a great dog. He, you know, he's trained for the house, meaning that, you know, he's, like, respectful to everybody. He goes to his places and spaces. He's not urinating in the house. He's great for the house, but I haven't really worked. And he's social, right? So he's relatively social. He does, as he's getting older, he's getting less friendly with strangers. But, I mean, that's kind of what I got him for. I don't necessarily need him to be, like, super friendly. But he's not attacking people either. So he's right now, he's just kind of like very wary when I take him on his walks. So, top 10 dogs for the surviving apocalypse. Man, I saw that video already and I thought about making it. I had thought about making it before I saw it. I had made a video about a good dog for the... I'm a big fan of Walking Dead, so I was thinking, like, what dog would go on that show? And that's kind of like, you know, what dog would I put on there for you? That's like the apocalypse, basically, right? It's a zombie show, but it's kind of like an end-of-the-world kind of thing. Everything, all the all the systems of society have kind of broken down. And I think I chose my number one dog, I think, would have been the American Pit Bull Terrier. But honestly, okay, I just lost a light. I think I just lost my, what light did I just lose? Just lost my backlight. All right, so I'll be going in a little bit. I could probably do that. I can think about doing that. I got to figure out whether the breeds I would think. I'm not really a hound person. If I had to choose a hound, because I hate the way hounds bark. I hate that. I hate that. I'm just thinking about, like, if I had to live with it, right? Like, if I'm at your house and your bloodhound or your basset hound is barking, it ain't driving me crazy. But just to have to, like, that barky, singy thing. I would take a bloodhound, just a bigger dog. I just would take a bloodhound over a basset hound. And that would just be based on size, to be honest with you. I like German Shepherds. But for me, you know, on The Walking Dead, it's too much. They're going through the woods too much. And I don't like the idea of long-haired dogs going through brush, right? Because they leave markings. Like, when your dog's shedding, like, they're going to know where you are because your dog is shedding. Or you're going to be constantly having to pick things out of your dog's hair. So for me, plain and simple, in the apocalypse, and just in my life, honestly, it's going to be a short-haired dog. You know, I think it would be great for, like, if you saw I Am Legend, those German Shepherds were bomb, right? They were smart. They were hunting. They added value to his life. Like, he added value to his situation, which I think is a great thing. So I like German Shepherds. I just don't like all the hair. Let's see, what do you think about the best home defense dog is fully trained? I mean, honestly, there's a lot of great dogs. I mean, honestly, there's a lot of great dogs. I mean, it really would more so depend on the training and what dog would I want to live with, right? American Bulldogs would be great, just depending on the training. Dobermans are great. Rottweilers are great. Cane Corso are great. I don't like Belgian Malinois. I don't like German Shepherds. I could do a German Shepherd for home protection. I could not. I can't live with a Belgian Malinois. That's the problem with that. So, but there are a lot of great dogs for that. I think, you know, American Bulldog, Cane Corso, Rottweiler, maybe even a Dogo. Dogos are good. A good home protection, first-time home protection dog, I think would be a Bull Mastiff would be great. I mean, honestly, listen, bro, to me, let's just be honest, right? Home protection is a tricky thing because the reality of it is that if a person is content on getting in your home, no dog is going to stop them, right? No dog is going to stop them. Dogs are easy to figure out. The best part about having a dog is that they bark. That they hear things and they bark. So, I mean, you know, any dog that's like my in-laws have like a 15 or 20 pound little mutt. But if anyone comes near the house, he's barking. So, you know, you're not surprised by anybody knocking on the door. And I mean, he's not protecting the home. He's more of, I guess, a watchdog or an alarm system. But let's just be honest. Like, if someone really wants to get in your house, you know what I'm saying? Or they really want to get something out of your house, they're going to bring the necessary tools to dispatch of your dog. So, I mean, honestly, I think the best thing that we're really talking about home protection, you're talking about a dog that's alert and protective so that they will alert you to someone's, to a stranger's presence. Beyond that, then you want, you know, the dog to look scary because a person, most people, like if it's just a random burglar, he sees a scary dog, he's not prepared to deal with it, he'll leave. And then if you want some real, like, you know, James Bond stuff where you got trained killers trying to get in your house, you know, a dog that's going to actually run at the killer and maybe delay him, because if that is a trained killer, he's going to kill the dog. It's not a question of that. He's there for something serious. He's going to do what he has to do. But your dog will buy you more time because he will engage the person, maybe try to put a bite on them, maybe, you know, do a bark and hold or something to hold them up. So, yeah, those are my thoughts on home protection. I know a lot of people get into the thought of like, yeah, I'm going to get a killer. He's going to rip somebody up and all that stuff. That's just a liability. You don't want a dog that's just like ready to rip through things and all that stuff. You really want a dog. Okay, I just lost another light. All right, so we want to get up out of here. It still looks pretty good though. It's not bad looking lighting. But I'm about to get up out of here. It's almost midnight where I'm at. Thank you guys for talking with me. I appreciate you. I'm gonna probably delete this video. This is just me checking out my lighting. I had ordered some wall units to plug these lights into the wall, but I don't know why they're not here yet. I'll get them up and going. And I will work on some live interviews for next week. I'm thinking hopefully we'll have something by Wednesday at least, if not sooner. Or for this week, I guess not. Today's Sunday, so yeah, for this week. All right, guys. I do appreciate you guys. Take it easy. Have a great day. Yes, please stay safe. In the memory of George Floyd, stay safe. Be productive. Be constructive. Let's not tear the world apart. Let's not tear at each other. My biggest belief is if you can love a dog, you should have no problem loving people. Right? And everyone here, I believe, is for the most part dog lovers. That's why you add Dogumentary TV. So we should be part of the solution, not never part of the problem. All right, guys. Take it easy, all right? Peace. Thanks for chilling with me.